Hello again. This is part two of the talk I'm giving on writing about film online, trying to make research para-academic. The first part was about various premises and preconditions of it and what might stimulate it in terms of topics that might be considered or incidents and occasions that might prod us to write online. And I talked a little bit about some of the writing premises. What I'd like to talk about now are particular writing strategies. I see that there are really two basic ones. One is to organize your piece, the online piece, as a narrative, as a story. This is common in journalistic writing, of course, especially long-form pieces tend to be about a particular figure in the news or about the reporter's own inquiry and how they proceeded step by step to explore the story. I use that seldom. I think it's rarer for academic writing in general. But I have used it a couple times, and I'll give you a quick example. One is a series I did on the emergence of digital projection in the early part of the 2010s, and how that had an effect on theaters of various kinds, big multiplexes, but also small theaters in small towns. And one of those small towns was a place called Harmony, Minnesota, and a theater there called The Gem was under a great deal of pressure to convert to digital screenings. Films were no longer being made available on film reels, and they would have to either convert to digital projection based on files or close down. And I heard about them, I read about them online mostly, and I made contact with the lady running the theater. And so I went there, this is, you know, a short drive from where I live, and spent a day there finding out the story behind their struggle to convert the theater for digital projection. So I based the story really on how they managed to overcome the obstacles to doing that, to creating a modern up-to-date projection system for this little town. But this was rare. Like most academics, I work with another kind of writing organization, that of argumentation. That has its own distinctive pattern of development and structure that I thought would be worth exploring with you for a minute, even though I'm sure you're aware of these. I tend to think of argumentative organization as trying to present your case, your sense of informed opinion about something, in a very structured way. And I see the structure as looking like this, a kind of anatomy, where you have a broad hook, something that is general, of something of general interest. It might be general to a very wide audience, or it might be general within a specialized audience, but it's something about the broader implications of what is you're going to be discussing. I'll give you an example of this shortly. And then we have a thesis, which is the actual concrete set of questions you're asking or the conclusions you've come to, hinted at, not necessarily stated openly. And that can be represented, this whole opening section, which might be a paragraph or several paragraphs, can be thought of as an inverted triangle, where the upper part is really the many points of access that different kinds of readers might have in coming to grips with what you're going to say. Whereas by the end of this opening stretch, the thesis should be something more concrete and specific and focused, a set of questions you're going to try to answer or a claim you're going to try to back up. So that's the way I think of that part of the organization. Then the body of the argument, I tend to think of as a set of reasons to support the thesis. Why would you believe this? What premises or principles undergird it. So that's a series of sections, paragraphs or several paragraphs, that develop one reason rather than another than another. And these can be several of these, of course. Then the reasons themselves, I think, are supported by evidence and examples. So within those sections or paragraphs, you develop this, that, and the other as supporting evidence, you might say, for the reason, which in turn supports your thesis. This is a familiar structure, I think, to people writing papers, and it's one that I would recommend for these long-form blog writings as well. And then I think of the ending, where you restate the thesis, summarize it, sometimes cleverly varying what you said before, and then broaden out to suggest the implications of it. It matters somewhat more than just a narrow set of cases that you've been considering. And that's why I represent it as a triangle, again, with the base being the broader implications. Now, this sounds rather abstract, I know, but I'll try to make this anatomy, this skeleton, clearer shortly. In the meantime, let me talk a bit about the openings. I think that we should often, more than we academics usually do, about titles and to some extent images. But in writing online, as I said, I think images are very important. So titles can be focused on for a minute here. Titles, I think, are the first way that you engage your reader. With a title, you tell your reader something that you're going to be talking about, but not necessarily in the most straightforward way. You can hint, you can play a game, you can tease, you can try to snare them a little bit. So for instance, in this instance of a blog called They're Looking for Us, there was a bit of a pun there. I mean, on the one hand, if you say they're looking for us, that implies somebody seeking you, the reader. But actually what the point of this was to show that there are characters in films that watch what we see in the films, and their watching kind of prompts or cues us for how to respond. Or sometimes what we see in terms of their response is itself part of the fun of the film. So in this case, Springtime for Hitler, we see not only this rather silly musical number, which is funny in itself, but also we derive some enjoyment from the absolutely shocked and appalled response of the audience that can't believe what they're seeing. So they're looking for us really means that they're both surrogates for us, but also the object of our enjoyment as well. We enjoy watching other people reacting to the things we're reacting to. That's one way I thought we might try to grab the audience. And indeed, you see the pictures also play a role in that. Another example is a blog I did about a film called The Locket, where we get, I think, a rather striking image in itself. The painting of the woman with the hollow eyes juxtaposed to a woman looking very doleful and mysterious. That, I think, might intrigue the reader in and of itself. But also, I have a title, Chinese Boxes, Russian Dolls, and Hollywood Movies. And that's a reference to stories within stories. That is, in English, we talk about Chinese boxes as a box within a box within a box, the way a story can be within a story, within another story, a broader story. Or the idea of Russian dolls, the matryoshka, where the doll is inside another doll is inside another doll. And that seemed to me also to kind of intrigue the audience as well. But the problem there was, I don't advise you to use the phrase Russian dolls if you're writing online, because this, though it got a lot of hits, attracted a different kind of clientele than we normally have. People who were looking, I think, for, playmates from the former Soviet Union. For a couple days, we had some hits from other sites that we don't normally see. We also know that openings are very important, but they have to be followed up. They have to pay off. And sometimes openings can get you into trouble. It was a dark and stormy night, in Charles Schulz's Peanuts cartoon. Your new novel has a very exciting beginning. Thank you. Good luck with the second sentence. And Schroeder's right. The second sentence is always the problem, the payoff. So, for instance, Tinker Tailor, A Guide for the Perplexed, I thought I would try to engage the audience by describing how people were responding to the film. As the final credits rolled, a man behind me blurted out, "I don't get it." And I thought that would maybe snag the audience and make them think, okay, I didn't really get that film either, or why didn't he get it, or what is it about the film that doesn't let him get it, and so forth. So I thought that would be a way to kind of ensnare some audience members, some readers. However, you have to be careful, you have to be prepared for a lot of people to take things in different ways. I wrote another post, much more recently, starting off, in some ways, Christopher Nolan has become our Stanley Kubrick. Now, I didn't think that was inflammatory in any way. I thought that was actually something I was prepared to defend in certain respects. As I say, in some ways, he is a parallel figure to Stanley Kubrick. But this ignited some controversy on the part of another critic, Jonathan Rosenbaum, who said that this made him stop reading at that point. When he saw that, it was so outrageous, to him at least, so ridiculous, that he didn't even want to read further. I didn't think it was too far-fetched, but he did, and some of his Facebook followers did. So later, about a year later, year and a half later, I tried to address that and say I think that there was a bit of a stretch. Anyway, you can read about that on the blog if you want. So openings can be captivating, but they can also be a bit risky. One thing that I enjoy about writing online is the fact that the writing strategies that are involved can be quite reader-friendly, can be easy. You can have what I call frictionless footnoting and clustered citations. A lot of academic writing, particularly those that use a certain kind of format, really clogs up the prose with parentheses and superscript numbers and things like that that indicate your sources, either the parentheses with dates and sources or the superscript footnote or endnote numbers. And I'm nothing against them. I've used them many times myself, but the thing is that they are not too hospitable to the kind of readership that you might want to attract. So, for instance, I like the fact that in an online piece of writing, you can have hyperlinks that let you, in a sense, footnote what you're saying by, in this case, the links that are given in color coding that lets you, if people want to look at the source of what you're saying or the example you're giving, they can just click on it and see it. Otherwise, they just read right over it. And the same thing with allowing for things that aren't online that can't be linked to, you can cluster as a bunch of citations. We tend to do that at the end, below that horizontal line that you see there. So if people want to follow up on a book or an article that we've mentioned that isn't available online, we can give the source there rather than clutter up the text itself and break the flow of the argument. Now, there are, I think, two principal research directions that we tend to follow on our online activities, and I'll try to sketch those. One is a critical analysis of single films or group of films. We take a look at a particular movie or a group of movies and try to come to some conclusions about them, about their artistic qualities. Here's an example. I saw Johnny Do Kei Fung's film, Cold War, and liked it very much, and so I wrote a blog about it. Full of spoilers, I assume that your reader would try to go see the film, but I wanted to do an analysis of the film because I think it's a very important accomplishment in recent film history. The other tendency we find in our blog is a historical analysis of trends, not tied to maybe a single film, but more generally. So for instance, there's a debate, I don't know if there's a debate here about this, but in America, there's a debate about whether cinema as we know it, theatrical movie going, is ending up, is dying, because of streaming or because of other ways of accessing film. Is the theater experience pretty much on the way out? And corollary to that is the idea that maybe the two-hour movie is on its way out. Maybe people want either very short-form things like they can see on YouTube or long-form things that they can see by binging whole series like 3, 4, 5 episodes at a time. So this debate has been going on, and we felt it would be interesting to make our own conclusions about this. So I wrote a blog about whether that idea of the end of the theatrical film, the mid-sized feature film, was valid. And I think it's worth exploring. In fact, I think it's, in a way, your market, the Hong Kong and Chinese market, is proof that indeed it's still a very valid form, the theatrical two-hour movie. One writing strategy that I find is particularly important for writing online is what I call going deeper gradually. If you're writing for a specialized audience, you can assume a level of expertise right from the start, right from the beginning. In fact, it might be considered insulting to try to spell out everything that you are thinking in a linear fashion. There's a lot of rewards for starting at a very high level of discourse, assuming the audience knows a lot, and then probing beyond that. I find that I have to start more slowly in writing online. If I want to capture those non-specialist readers, I think I have to go deeper gradually. And I'll give you an example by showing one blog, and a blog that's been rather successful for us. It's one of our top 10 blogs almost every day. It's a very old one now, but it's one I think that does illustrate this. It's about a film I've already mentioned, Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, and it's one that was enjoyed and successful, but not particularly fully understood. As I mentioned, the opening anecdote says someone stands up and says, "I didn't get it, really." So my question was really twofold. One is, what's going on in the movie? Can I kind of explain it for people who might want to cheat sheet after they've seen the movie to figure out what they saw? But secondly, I wanted to know, why is it difficult? Why did the filmmakers seem to decide to make something that was more opaque, obscure, or roundabout than a normal movie? So it was partly an issue about the craft of filmmaking, why you would design a movie to become somewhat more complex and harder to pick up on the first pass. So that's what I tried to do after the opening, where I try to establish the fact that people do find it a difficult film to follow the plot line of. I then wanted to peel it away and show how step by step we can show that its difficulties are really strategic. They really are aiming to make us not only work a little harder in following the action, but also to follow up a kind of probing of the theme and subject of the film. So the first chunk of the argument, and this is an example of the reasons-based, evidence-based argumentative structure I talked about before, was to ask about what is so unconventional about this film? What's breaking things up? And so I start with some of the examples of how some of the scenes aren't handled in quite the normal way, talking about how they're not as linearly constructed as scenes usually are. I then move to the idea of how certain genre conventions aren't quite as obvious in this film as they are in other spy films. As you probably know, it's a film about international intrigue, and some of the things you find in normal spy films, long explanations and exposition of who's against who or what the various gambits are in the spy game, aren't really spelled out as explicitly. The filmmakers seem to take for granted the fact that we kind of know how these films go, and they can leave out some things that another kind of film would spell out more. I then wanted to explore how these things work in terms of the characterizations of the film. I try to talk about how we're left to try to figure out characters' motives and their reasonings in terms of the action that we see. I also wanted to look at the three main male characters of the film and how their relationships seem to govern this opacity of the film. George Smiley, the investigator, and then the two other men who are at the center of the film. I wanted to probe them and see what we can glean from the fact that their motives are eventually revealed, but aren't spelled out very clearly at the outset. And finally, I wanted to talk about how the key problem or question I think that the film raises for viewers is the motivation of the protagonist, George Smiley himself, and how his mind is working and what he knows at various points. And there are various efforts the film makes to drop clues about what he's thinking and why he's doing certain things, but they aren't made as explicit. There's a riddle about his character that I think finally only crystallizes at the very end of the film. So as I say, it's a kind of a peeling away of the film's various strategies for making its story a little bit difficult, a little bit unconventional, in order to explore the ramifications of both the genre conventions, but also the characters in the film. And then I tried to wrap it up with a conclusion at the end. Does it work? Is it of value? Is it interesting? I tend to think it is. I think it's worth having adventurous films like this that try to stretch the boundaries of normal cinema. But that's an example of what I mean of developing a case from a thesis through reasons, examples, evidence, and then to a restatement of the thesis and a conclusion. Now, I've mentioned only prose criticism online, the kinds of things that we do with writing and pictures, but there's many other varieties, and I should just mention the audiovisual criticism, which is now commonly known as video essays. There are many of these, and they can be quite brilliant. I think one very good one is Patrick Keating's Motifs of Movement and Modernity, where instead of a prose description that you have to read, you get voiceover commentary and film analysis with moving images and cuts and montages and juxtapositions and very elaborate kinds of presentation. I think this is great. This is very, very interesting. I did it a little bit in a piece that's on our blog, our website, Constructive Editing in Bresson's Pickpocket, where I tried to talk about how editing works to build up a space and when the audience has to fill in the gaps. But most of the things like this online are like the presentation I'm giving now, which are just PowerPoint presentations with my voiceover and still images. In a way, though, that video essay impulse is being carried out by what we're doing now through a streaming service on the Criterion Channel, which has a series every month. We have one 12 to 15 minute discussion of a technique as it's used in a particular film. And that's in a way been our equivalent of that audiovisual criticism that other people do in their proprietary sites. So to sum up, I think para-academic writing online is a very promising way to go if you're interested in exploring the possibilities of what you can do with your research in accessing a wider audience. It's easy to think of it as mostly just dissemination, and maybe that's been an implication of what I've been saying. Maybe you would just carry away from this, oh, this is a way for me to get my ideas out there more, a megaphone, a way to broaden my appeal. It is certainly part of that. I do want to get a broader audience interested in the ideas I find exciting. But I also think it's a workshop, a laboratory, a way to develop ideas for you and your readers. You can use this as a kind of creative vessel for you to explore what you think. It's not as though we as researchers come up with our ideas, formulate our arguments, and then just lay them out and that's the end of it. We develop them as we write about them. We discover our subject, we discover what we think about our subject as we start to develop the arguments. You know, the English poet W.H. Auden said, "How can I know what I think until I see what I say?" And I feel that that's as true of academic writing as it is for poetry. The act of writing itself is a stimulation for creating and developing ideas, arguments, and hopefully conclusions that are useful and productive. So thank you for your attention. Thank you very much. And again, I really regret that I can't be here with you, but I hope that some of this has proven useful. Thanks again, and feel free to check on our website at any time. Thank you very much.